You know, it sucks because now looking back at the Gambit system, it kind of sounds like it might be fun to play. Just thinking about it, I forgot about it. It's like a chain of commands, and if one fails, you go to the next one.
Yeah, it's like a very basic programming language, basically.
Yeah.
It's just like you set priorities, and it's just, is this requirement met? Then do this.
I think if I went in looking at the game that way, as opposed to wanting my traditional turn-based RPG experience,
it
would be a much different experience. I could enjoy it.
Yeah. And like I said, that's kind of that particular moment is a Let's Player's dream. It's like, we get there.
Just sit back.
Yeah, we get there, and it's like, okay, we're going to end the recording here. We're at, like, what are we at? Like, level 25, level 30? Okay, we'll see you in a little bit, and then just let it run until we record again. It's like, oh, everyone's level 99 and has all the license points. We don't have to worry about shit. We can blitz this game.
I don't think I had time to appreciate how awesome this battle is last time.
No, yeah.
That thing's flying.
It's flying and throwing you all around.
That's so cool.
And we failed this.
Oh, no.
Yeah. See, again, another environmental... At the very least, though, they're going to restart us right here.
Yeah.
It'd be one... It would be infuriating if you had to start the whole fight over again because you failed this one quick time.
I really just feel bad letting Bayo down.
Yeah.
I just, like, I'm sorry, Bayo. You could have done so much better if I wasn't in control.
Yeah. But like we said, Bayo is always in control and confident and competent and whatnot. And so when the only time she's ever not in control is when you're fucking up.
She's throwing this thing at it.
She's doing a giant swing with it, which is the dumbest wrestling move, and then hurling it at this angel dragon.
Oh, man.
Like, if there was an angel dragon in a D&D source book, I would just turn the page. Nope. We're never gonna fight that thing. Mm-mm.
Ah, jeez, that was cool. When you're in the moment, you know it's cool, but you're also just so... focused on everything else and trying so hard that you just can't really think about how cool that shit is.
Well, that's why we got a Pizza Pasta Award.
What a day! Tony!
Oh, Tony, Tony, Tony!
I was thinking about how delicious a pizza pasta would be. Or a pasta pizza. I would eat both of those things.
Yeah.
I want to make one or the other, or both. A pizza pasta would be pretty easy. That'd be the easiest one. A pasta pizza...
That's a little harder, but yeah, pizza pasta. What would that be? That'd be like chunks of pepperoni.
A pizza pasta? Yeah, it'd be, you would take a pasta, right?
Yeah.
I would think like a really thick noodle. Yeah, uh-huh. And then you would just put like some thicker cuts of sausage and olive and pepperoni in there with a nice thick marinara sauce. Mm-hmm. That'd be delicious.
Yeah, that'd be... Mm.
Now, pasta pizza, I was thinking you take all your noodles and then maybe... fry them slightly in a pan so that they take the form of a crust, and then put your toppings on that, perhaps.
Or you just
have your pizza crust and you make your regular pizza, but then you also put noodles on it. That seems redundant.
Possibly. It could be a form of lasagna almost. You lay down your noodles, but
pasta pizza.
You maybe make the noodles like two layers thick, or put some sort of, I don't know, maybe like a small layer of sausage in there.
Something.
I don't know.
Gotta figure that one out.
Yeah.
I want to see a pasta pizza.
So this whole place is on fire now.
And she
because
just,
Bayo came to town.
Still, it's good. Oh, yeah. I remember running through this.
When Bayo goes on vacation, make sure you have your insurance in order.
When Bayo paints the town red, she just catches everything on fire. That's what it means.
And then puts her lipstick on and is like, what?
Well, maybe it's red also with the juice of the angels.
There's that too. Yeah. Oh, that'd be terrible if the angels like died, but all the juices came out of purgatory.
Oh,
everything's just covered in
just
cranberry juice and blister fluid.
Just
like, what the fuck?
You're walking away from a food truck with you're like unwrapping a burrito, and you just open your mouth, and then you just hear this splash, and you're like, why am I warm and wet? Why? You're just like covered, or it's in your mouth, like,
it's dripping off your nose just slowly from this angle for some reason. Just like zooms in, just no, as this one drop falls down, goes bloop.
You know, it happens so quick, you're thinking to yourself, everything's red. I don't remember everything being red, but I don't remember everything turning red either.
Yeah. It's just suddenly everything was red. Am I colorblind now? Or have I always been colorblind and now I'm not?
Is this just life?
Are things red now? No. Yeah, not everything is red.
Now I want a burrito or a pasta pizza.
Yeah, or a burrito, pasta pizza burrito.
Whoa.
It's a burrito filled with pasta pizza inside of a burrito. So it's like a little churro or chimichanga or those little shitty burritos you get.
Yeah.
Shoved in one of those giant burritos you get from any Mexican stand.
Yeah.
Because that's the only burrito they know how to make for $5.
I'm trying to think of the Mexican pizza at Taco Bell, right?
Yeah.
That's one of those obscure items that you don't see very often. What is... That's kind of... I'm trying to see what they did, and then how would you spin that into pasta pizza. So
Maybe
like big sheets of lasagna, and then lots of cheese and
sauce. Like some way to get the lasagna to firm up without getting... Well, no, even if it got crispy... This thing, how do you do that without burning the noodle?
I don't know.
That's the problem.
I really want to figure this out.
Yeah.
We make millions! The pasta pizza, and the pizza pasta.
Mm-hmm. The PPPP.
And then, Italians come by and they're like, hey, Tony!
Tony?
This place has got pizza pasta.
Do they have pasta pizza?
Hey, Tony!
Yeah, Tony!
They got pasta pizza!
Oh!
And then they're like, and then, yeah, they get the Italian seal of approval. Oh,
I miss German Shepherd Puppy.
I hope she's doing well.
Me too. But I don't know if she is, because we learned about her because her owners weren't taking good care of her.
Yeah.
Just walking to the gym one night. No, hey, puppy. Where is your home? You're just going to follow us for a while? That's cool.
I remember where you live. Follow me. I'll bring you home.
Yeah.
Hey, here's your dog, sir.
What?
Oh. Opens the door. What? We found your dog just wandering around. We knew it belonged here, so we brought it to you. Oh. Let the dog come in, and then it closes the door.
What a
dick.
I know. What a cock. We would have taken such better care of GSP.
I mean, and it's not even so much that, you know, it's not like you do it for the thank you. You do it for... It wouldn't hurt to get a thank you. I wouldn't turn it away. I wouldn't plug up my ears if someone was going to say thanks. But yeah, I wanted to bring the dog back. And being a dog owner, you know what kind of fucking stress and you could be under if you lost your dog.
Oh, yeah.
So just wanted to see that. There's no emotion on this guy's face. Oh. Shut the door.
Like this dog is some burden.
Ah.
Like his wife insisted they get the dog and he doesn't give a shit about it. I don't know. She always seemed to be outside. Even in the bad weather.
Uh-huh.
Although it was fun seeing her in the good weather.
Uh-huh.
And like, you haven't fallen in the sun.
It was always fun when she would bark at other people but us.
Yeah.
And then even while we were petting her, and then someone walks by and she would bark at that person.
Uh-huh.
And then come back to get more pets.
Ah, German Shepherd puppy. Not even a puppy, just an Australian Shepherd or whatever it is.
Yeah.
So she looks like a puppy her whole life.
Yeah, she looked like, it was like a mini German Shepherd.
Yeah.
Look, but she was just, full grown. I was trying to, this is something. I think it was still about the pizza. Oh, no. I was going to say, it's still on German Shepherd puppy. Maybe them seeing us, like being creeps
with
their dog.
It could be.
Maybe they're like, maybe we should bring her in, and then they have a newfound like, you know, love of her once they let her in, because like, those boys, us not being children, but those weird boys out there really like our dog, sweetie. Maybe we should bring her in.
What boys? The ones that always speak Italian to her. Or in bad Italian accents, at least.
They're Italian boys? Well, no. Well,
pretty sure they're not.
They just have, they just talk like a stereotypical.
Yeah, they just walk around and they go, hey, German Shepherd puppy, how you doing?
Having fun in the sun?
Well, you got it made in the shed.
And then we look up.
And they're there.
That was the
Her owner's just there. Hi.
Hopefully that was enough to make them go, let's bring her in, or else they're probably going to steal her one day.
Oh, never steal a dog, but...
If there was one dog I would ever steal...
I guess it'd be German Shepherd Puppy.
Yeah.
And then swap her with Riggs and see if they notice.
Hello. okay.
Pony, I think the dog is sick. Nah. Okay.
Whatever.
Hello.
I know we've talked about Bayo's attack noises, but I really love them.
Oh yeah,
I really,
great.
Especially when you get a full combo and like it goes to like from that lower hook to the like ha, you know, like every move when she jumps and kicks is a little different.
Mm-hmm. I love how she holds that sword when she runs. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that's, you know, a practical way of holding a sword, but it doesn't seem ridiculous the way the woman holding a sword in anything usually looks. Because normally you have a woman holding a sword in anything, especially when the woman is just supposed to be neat.
Yeah.
You know, they hold it up and high, like by their shoulder. And whether or not that's proper, it just looks ridiculous because you know they chose that because it's like, okay, that's going to show off your boobs.
And they always have that pose with their legs where their feet are turned into each other and their knees are buckling because all like weak and fatigued.
Yeah.
Like just holding this giant weapon and it's all cute and stuff. And it's like,
oh.
And I just like, it's a, there's a super lyrical and rhythmic quality to, obviously rhythmic because it's like, we talked about how this is kind of a rhythm game in a way. But when you do a long combo, it just sounds cool. It's just real good like beat to it, and real good cadence. I'd like to take a tuner and see like what, you know, some people usually speak in a key. There's a certain note key they like to stick around. I was doing this with my voice and it was around a C and sometimes B sharp around there. And I'd like to hear where her hoo-ha-ha's lie, just to see, you know? Fairness.
These things aren't fair at all. As you're about to find out.
Yeah, that wasn't fair. They've been doing that a lot lately.
They do that with almost every enemy introduction. It seems like they shoot bullshit at you.
Right after the introduction, yeah. This is the third time I feel like it's happened.
I hate that ability.
It just sounds bad. She's like, yeah, jeez, that sounds terrible.
We don't get nearly as much use out of that stinger as we should.
Yeah.
It's just, it's because of the controls in this one. They clean the controls up even when they get the Bayo 2. I've kind of forgotten what the problem was here, but I remember it being like the button that's what it was. Here, to lock on, you press the equivalent of R1, but, you know, you use R2 to attack.
Uh-huh.
And I don't want to use my index finger and my middle finger.
Uh-huh.
Whereas in Bayo 2, it's in most games like this, it's L2 to lock on.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas here, L2 swaps your weapon types.
It makes sense. You have L2 to you know, aim down the sights, so to speak. R2 to fire. Yeah,
and so I kept running into the problem where I think I'm locking on, but suddenly I'm using a different attack pattern. Like, what the hell?
Oh, switching.
That's right. I totally forgot.
Man, we didn't even get all the weapons. I kind of feel bad about that.
Yeah.
But it makes me want to play it again.
Yeah.
Get them all.
I got most of them in Bayo 2. The only one I know I didn't get is one that you get from fighting Rodan, because he's a super boss who will kick your shit.
What's he just kind of like, hey, you want to fight for funds? Or is he...
Kind of. It's an item you have to buy, and then you can fight him. And if you fight him, you get some special weapon, which I have no idea what it does. Kind of interested, but I know he would kill me. And it costs 9,999,999 halos to buy the ticket.
Oh.
And I think you have to buy a new ticket for every attempt.
Wow.
I don't know that for certain, but I think that's the case.
Yeah, she runs like she's about to just cleave someone in half. She's not dragging the tip or anything.
Ugh, I hate it when they do that in anything.
And it's like leaving a spark trail?
Yeah. Like, there's a hero in, League of Legends.
Mm-hmm.
That's just how he runs.
Yeah. And he runs really slow, too, if I remember right.
It makes sense that he runs slow, but it's kind of dumb how he carried. Man,
I feel like if he were to just lift his sword up, he'd run faster.
Yeah, maybe carry it in such a way that, like, the weight of it is pitching him forward a little bit. Mm-hmm. So it's giving him a little bit of momentum.
And it's just like, man, if it's that heavy to drag it like that.
Dude, look at Bayo right now.
She's just like, this is warming me up. Nice. Just rides this thing. She's still got a little bit of that embarrassing mom in her, though, where it's like,
says something
that's... just because you said it was cool, but...
Just because you grew up in the 70s.
If I try to say that, it wouldn't fly.
No, dancing a go-go, baby. It, no. No. Women are not going to come on to me. Having never even heard that, they just know I said it at some point.
You just walk into a bar and just, excuse me, everybody, and the music stops. You're like, dancing a go-go, baby. All right, now that we got that out of there, you know what you're getting into if you come have a conversation with me.
I just say that, and then it cuts back to the bar, and just big guys are putting on brass knuckles and start snapping little keys in half. Yep, I'll go home.
Just leave a tip for him anyway, for the bartender. I apologize.
I was going to talk about something, but I totally forgot.
Yeah. Happens to me, too.
Because suddenly Bayo was just super confident and then rode that angel. So I got really distracted.
Yeah, every time Bayo does cool stuff, which is a lot of the time, I get really distracted because watching us play is really fun compared to... Well, not that it's more or less fun than playing. Playing's obviously funner.
Yeah.
But I get to experience different things.
Yeah.
And it's cool.
You get to actually pay attention to the animation.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I'm watching the way she executes certain attacks and knowing that, knowing that stronger attacks just take more frames and that's the risk-reward thing you're dealing with. But watching how they pace out the frames and how she winds up for an attack or how she steps into a certain attack.
Yeah, there's a full natural movement into it. No matter how unnatural the move is, it's not just like she's standing and the attack happens. She actually gets into it.
Yeah, all the transitional animations are super, just great to see. Really nice.
Oh, I remember now. I was gonna talk about League of Legends because I don't think there's a game that I've. How do I put this? I don't think there's been a game that I've ever been so initially interested in and then so immensely. Even Final Fantasy 13, I haven't lost as much interest in as League of Legends. Just watching it, I bought into that game early. When I got back from Afghanistan in November of 2009, one of the first things I did when I got my internet hooked back up in my barracks was check out this League of Legends thing I read about in this magazine. You know, and it was a lot of fun, so I actually bought into it. They have, like, the Founders Pack or whatever, where you get a handful of heroes and some extra skins and, like, a bunch of their bonus currency or whatever. And then just watching it evolve and shift over the past 6 years, wow, this is not the same game.
Yeah.
I don't mean that in a good way, the way that WoW isn't the same game it was 6 years ago. I realized, oh, the community is full of shitheads. Like, at least 10% of that community are rancid shitheads, and since it's always 5v5, you're guaranteed to have one shithead, at least, per match. And whether he's on your team and you're winning, or he's on the other team and they're winning, wherever he is, however his team is doing, he's ruining the time. And seeing them shift their public face from this real fun kind of presentation, where the mascot used to be Tristana, and if you know League of Legends, she's this little blue... I forget what they call the race, but they're these little blue people, and she has this great big cannon, and she's real goofy and real fun, and she used to be the public face of the game, more or less, and then it became this other character named Katrina, who is the sexy assassin lady.
With, like, her zipper on her chest all open.
So she doesn't even have that. She has, like, a halter top made of chainmail.
I'm trying to picture.
She has, like, a halter top made of chainmail, and then long red hair, and she's, you know... real life, not whatever, but she became the public face around 2011 or so when we went to PAX.
Big old statue of her.
Huge statue of her. She's front and center on all of the promotional art. Just front and fucking center on everything. And like after they did that, they released like some sort of thank you to the fans for hitting some sort of milestone. And that had Tristana on it. And so it was weird that they seem to be... For the longtime fans, it's like they're still using Tristana, but whenever they go anywhere, it's, oh, look at Kat and her fucking chainmail halter top. And look at Tryndamere, he's big and muscly.
And now and look at now watch this video for Jinx. She'll give you a boner.
Within days, I stumbled across, I'll just say vile pornography of Jinx. I wouldn't even go with the specific type of vile
pornography. That character was made for that.
Yeah? Yeah, she probably was.
There's no way in hell they designed Jinx and were like, man, what else can we do to make people want to make more porn of her?
There's even a moment in her intro video where she's like lying in a bathtub.
Uh-huh.
There are bullets falling everywhere. It's embarrassing.
Yeah, it was really the thing that was that makes you had mentioned Final Fantasy 13 and then League of Legends and how you still you dislike League of Legends more.
Yeah.
Like, and the thing is because you get excited for Final Fantasy 13, you pop it in. Oh, this isn't what I expected.
Uh-huh.
Oh, well, that sucks. You get into League of Legends, you're like, this is really fucking fun.
Yeah, it was what... It was even more than what I expected at first. Like, I wasn't... I didn't play Defense of the Ancients back when it was a Warcraft 3 mod.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I think I did a couple of times, but I didn't get into it in the way that people who got into it did, which led to the creation of LoL and this whole subgenre of MOBAs now. But... You know, so I read about it in a magazine, and then I hopped into it, and I was like, wow, this is fun.
So
I like
fun.
This.
Yeah.
This is not like any other game I've played. This is great. I had fun with it. I liked the initial roster of characters. They were very disparate, and it took them years to start solidifying their art style, but they were fun. They were kind of goofy. They were
Warwick.
Yeah, some of them were serious. Some of them were just silly. Now, I think I'm still subscribed to their YouTube channel, and so I notice whenever they post a new thing about whatever their new champion is. I have no idea when they last posted a character that I would consider fun.
Yeah.
Not even in terms of play, because obviously I'm not playing the game.
Uh-huh.
Just a character you look at and you go, this character's a little goofy, this character's a little fun. Like, the closest to that would be Jinx, but she's still supposed to be, you know, sexy, dangerous lady, wearing... Even less than a cat. It's like, god damn it.
And so you have this fun-ass game that you're really into, and you would still probably enjoy playing, but then the community fucking ruins it
exactly,
for you.
Exactly,
yeah. And so there's this longing that's there, and you're like, yeah, the game's right there. It could be great, but the community is made up of the worst fucking people.
Like, honestly, if... I would just play against AI with my friends.
Yeah.
Like, if you could set the AI to a level of difficulty where it's comparable to a human, I would just... I don't care if I didn't get currency. You know?
Mm-hmm.
I would... If there was a character I really liked, I would just buy them with money.
Yeah.
Like, I'm thinking about doing that with Heroes of the Storm.
Yeah,
like,
I was going to say we need to play Heroes of the Storm.
Yeah, let's just play that, you and I, because you can play that against AI with AI. Like, I don't care if I don't get... currency. They have constantly rotating heroes, and they're all fun and interesting. And if I'm not playing against other people competitively, it doesn't matter that, oh, this character is, you know, not the best assassin. This character is not the best push. And you get like 10 free heroes once you hit a certain level, so you have plenty to choose from, even if you're, you know, don't have one all the time. But God, League of Legends just bums me out.
Yeah.
And then I had to laugh at it a few weeks ago because they're shutting down an entire map type. There was, when we went to PAX back in 2011,
they were
advertising
something new.
Dominion, which is like, you know, it's like a big circular map and it's like Capture the Flag or something, basically. And you remember how big that booth was.
Oh.
They're like, oh, this is the brand new way to play League of Legends. Come check it out for the first time in the whole world.
Yeah.
And we thought about it because I think we were still playing it at the time. And we saw, as soon as we got to that booth, it was capped out for the day.
Yeah.
They're like, nope, this, it's going to take the rest of the day to get through this line, sorry. So we didn't get a chance to play it. And then before I ever got a chance to play it, before it actually went live, I just got burned out on it.
Yeah, same here.
So I never played it, but so few people have been playing it that they're just shutting it down completely. It's like half a percent of the player base even checks it out in any given day.
It's like, I'm trying to think of a story, but it's you'll recognize the story, like the type of, you know, a lesson learned, right?
Mm-hmm.
Picture a town that has all their shops and bars and all that stuff, right? And it's humble. It's not a booming town, but it gets by and it has charm. And then a few outsiders come into this place and they're like, oh man, you know what would be really great is like this thing. And then all the little businesses in the town go, oh, these new people like that thing. Let's all do that thing.
Yeah.
They all start doing that thing, selling that one thing for this one type of person.
Uh-huh.
And then that person, those type of people that come into town go, you know what, we're done with this town.
Yeah.
See ya. And then And then they're like, oh, we have no more business because the only people that are left here are the people who either the original people who decided to stay are here and we have nothing for them. Mm-hmm. We are fucked.
Yeah.
And that's what it makes me think of. I wish I knew. I think there's like an episode of some TV show that does that exactly, and I wish I could remember. But it's just like, you know, this type. I don't even know if that player base was there from the beginning. I certainly didn't feel it at first. It was a much nicer community.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden these assholes came in and made it the worst. Mm-hmm. And then they're like, let's cater to these assholes. Let's make these super sexy characters and let's do this stuff. And then those assholes said, so, you know, we're done with you.
Yeah.
And now all the people that would have liked it left, but the ones that stuck around, they're, you know, they have to shut down maps and stuff because they can't afford to sustain it.
It's still the biggest, you know, game in its genre. The prize pool for it and Dota 2 completely trump what Heroes of the Storm has going on. But Heroes of the Storm just looks... And I've played it. I've had it for a long time. It just is more fun to me.
Yeah,
because they let themselves be goofy with it. They let themselves do... The people who play League of Legends and Dota 2 want to take it so goddamn seriously. They want to call it a sport.
Uh-huh.
That's why Dominion failed, because everyone wants to play on the one map all the time. Because, well, you don't change up the court with every basketball game. Well, it's not a fucking sport.
Yeah.
You also don't suddenly have a guy on one team who can throw fireballs.
Yeah.
You know, you don't change up the complete roster every time.
I mean, I understand playing it competitively.
Yeah.
It's the same thing, like I was talking about YouTube having a red carpet event.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you're not TV, you're not film. Don't do it. It's like, your games, yeah, play competitively, but you're not a fucking... You don't play by the same rules as basketball and football. Mm-hmm. Make up your own rules, your own new video game competitive rules.
Every goddamn esports team has the same... They all have the same individual photo where they're just, like, facing the camera at 45 degrees with their arms crossed, even though they're, like, 100 pounds overweight, and they don't look intimidating at all. And then it's the same team photo where it's just them in a line doing that, and you can see them all. It's like, wow, you're...
It's like, man. You know, and... yeah. That's the thing. They just... It's not fun. They made it so not fun.
Yeah.
It was, and I'm sure still is, a very fun game. Mm-hmm. But then when you have people that take it so seriously to the point where death threats, rape threats, you know, sexual harassment. All that stuff, like, I feel like it came from that community of gaming. Not specifically League of Legends, mm-hmm. but just that gamer type.
It just, for some, whatever reason, it just attracted that type of individual.
Not saying that everyone who plays competitive or takes a game seriously is a Gamergate douchebag, but it seems like that's where it came from. Like, that if you're willing to just talk such vile shit to someone over a video game,
I wonder if it's just the raw size of League of Legends that's why they have so many of those people.
Mm-hmm.
Because it seems
you're bound,
like,
to get them.
Same thing with, you know, Call of Duty. Except with League of Legends, they ended up actively courting... Like, those people came to Call of Duty by default. And I'm sure there were quite a few of them in League of Legends before they switched over to using Katrina as their main mascot. But I feel like they hit a certain growth point, and then they probably got investors. And they said, okay, we need to keep growing. We need to appeal to more people. And then that's why you get... sexy assassin.
Yeah.
Because then random bro sees that. It's like, oh, bro, what's this? And then they check it out.
And they're like,
and then they might have, they probably have fun with it.
Uh-huh.
You know?
Yeah,
it is a fun game.
Uh-huh,
so they have fun with it. And then they bring all their bros into it, and then you end up attracting the wrong crowd, basically. And just by raw numbers, and then to some extent, I'm victim blaming here, because yes, they changed their marketing style to attract a different set. And the set they attracted have a larger number of assholes than the people who went to that game by default, I think.
One of the sadder things about this is you take the gamer who plays your football games, your general sports games, or your shooters, or your racing car games.
Uh-huh.
Like, that's a different breed, those people that just play those games. and they want in on this new thing, so they give it this a try, even though it's nerd shit, right?
Yeah.
It's like magic and wizards and shit, this is lame, let's try it out. And they're like, oh, this is really fun.
Yeah.
They could have otherwise had their eyes open to a whole new world of gaming. They just turned it into another vile fucking mess.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And then that's a bummer. It's like you could have been enlightened. Mm-hmm. Instead, you turned it into just another platform for you to be a dick.
Just another, just another platform where I feel compelled to turn off chat. To just, if I could just leave team chat and world chat completely and pretend everyone else is just a robot, that'd be perfect.
Look at us fucking up here, probably me. I think
you were playing this.
Because I tried really hard for about like an hour afterwards.
Yeah. This one's hard. And this is like one of the beginner versions of these. These get really
rough. We didn't even find any. I think we found a...
They're all hidden in this one. In Bayo 2, they're on the main path. You can't help but see them for the most part. These ones are all squirreled away, like squirrels.
Isn't it fun seeing even a game like Bayonetta make the same improvements that a game like Crash Bandicoot would make?
Yeah, it is.
And, you know, really fucking similar, actually, where there's a lot of great ideas and great content in the first Crash game, but it's just difficult and a pain in the ass.
Yeah, there's just stuff they need to nail down. Mm-hmm. Even with controls, like Crash controls a lot better than the third one did in the first. Bayo controls a lot better in Bayo 2 than she does here. And you can consider that the third entry, basically, because Revengeance is a middle point, the way Crash Bandicoot 2 is, so it's a different series, but same developers, same genre, a lot of the same mechanics, so effectively it's a sequel to Bayo.
It's
fucking amazing. I can't believe how good it is.
You know, wasn't there a point when everyone thought it was going to be shitty?
Yeah. Well, it was going to be shitty before it became Revengeance.
Oh.
When it was being developed by Konami. And then they realized they don't actually know how to make a character action game. So they gave it to Platinum and gave them like a year, I think. And so Platinum, being Platinum, nailed it out of the park.
How does Platinum do such great work with such little budgets and such short times? Like,
well, you've seen how they do their cutscenes.
Yeah,
although
that's
they
true.
Don't do them that way in Revengeance. I probably because they had Konami money.
And even that Korra game wasn't the best, but it wasn't bad.
No, yeah, I've watched a full playthrough of it. Like, this is short, and there's only a few enemy types, but it's Platinum. It still looks like it plays really well, and like they know how to mix up the enemy types that always give you a challenge. And they know how to make a goddamn boss fight.
That Transformers game was supposed to be awesome.
Yeah, I want to get that when it's not too much money.
The Turtles are probably going to... That's going to be fantastic, I bet.
That one I'm not sure about.
Really?
I'm sure it's going to play well. I just want to see how it plays the thing, because it sounds... Oh, you finally got it, though. Maybe it was another one you were having so much trouble with.
I think it was the time. There was like
time,
a time.
That's
one.
Right, yeah. This one was just like...
Don't get hit.
Yeah.
You get hit like 4 or 5 times.
Because there's this new Turtles game, it sounds like you, kind of like a MOBA, you level up on each mission a little bit. So
as you go and then start back from scratch.
It sounds that way, yeah. The little snippet I read in Game Informer, they weren't clear on it, and I think that's because when they were given this information, it wasn't quite clear. It just sounded like it sounds like it might be open world, but also... Like, you get into missions and they're, like, instance parts of the world. Like, you can go to this street anytime you want, but when you go on this mission, it's a unique version of it. And apparently you start off at, like, level 1, and then you want to get to as high of a level as you can before you get to the boss of that level.
Almost.
So I'm curious to see how exactly that's going to work.
It makes me think of, like, a gauntlet game almost, too.
You're right.
That sounds, I could see it failing if they, similar to Final Fantasy 13, where they're like, everybody loves Call of Duty, how do we make this game more like Call of Duty, and then it just isn't that great, and so hopefully they're not like, everybody loves MOBAs, how do we make this more like a MOBA, and then...
Yeah, that's true.
I hope that doesn't happen.
I don't think it'll go that far. It's certainly not going to be a MOBA. They're probably, at most, they're probably just looking to that repeated character progression on like a permission basis as some sort of inspiration.
Because it could add for a little bit more freedom. Like
it does.
You play a game and you follow a certain skill tree or skill path or whatever, and you're like, well, but what would it have been like if I went more fast and dodgy as opposed to slow and strong?
Yeah, it definitely gives you a lot more chance as a player to experiment, because just like with a MOBA, particularly Heroes of the Storm, where you're constantly choosing talents, you're not like... In League of Legends and Dota 2, you have your set abilities and you just choose which one to level up and when. Whereas in Heroes of the Storm, you have a bunch of different talents and you're choosing which one do I want.
And so, and it's very situational too.
Yeah, exactly. So in a game, if they were to do something like that with Turtles in Manhattan, it basically be like, well, what's going on in this mission? Yeah. Am I just fighting like big bruisers? Then I'm going to take this skill set, or... You know, is there a particular type of boss coming up? Then I'm going to take this skill set to help deal with him.
Or you get to, you're getting towards the end of the stage and you're like, man, I'm not at the level that I wanted to be at. I better go this direction.
Uh-huh.
What is, oh, I was like, what is writhing on that pillar? But I think it was flying.
Yeah, it's just a bunch of, like, bird trumpet fuckers. You're about to eat it. I think? Oh, no. They didn't eat it. Rats.
With an awkward camera angle to keep running away from... Where'd they all go?
I don't know. I thought we fought them.
Where do you think the Wonderful 101 lies if you say that you would consider Revengeance a sequel?
I would consider Revengeance a direct sequel to Bayonetta in tone and all that, and mechanics. Wonderful 101 is... Wonderful 101 is to Bayonetta what Jack and Daxter is to Crash Bandicoot.
Okay.
Like this weird new experiment, basically.
Nice.
It's certainly not as successful as Bayonetta or Revengeance in terms of how it plays and in terms of sales, I'm pretty sure. It's still great, it's still really fun, but just because of the nature of the game and the scale of things, as fun as that is and as responsive as the game is, it's just
different.
It just has constant, small, nagging issues, which kept me, at least, from really managing to sink my teeth into it.
You have it?
I have it, yeah. I think it was one of the first Wii U games I bought.
Can I borrow it?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Can I borrow it tonight? I'm going to go home and play that shit.
Oh, yeah. It's really fun. It's loaded with personality, and it's... I said they know how to do boss fight.
I just want to see how to scale.
Yeah, they know how to do...
They nail that.
Yeah, I was about to say, they do scale better than anyone, and... In Wonderful 101, they probably do it better than anything ever. Just their ability to constantly up the stakes, even while sometimes drawing things down to a literal microscopic level.
I never watched Gurren Lagann, but I guess there's a reference to how there's scale shown in that towards the end of that series.
Oh, probably, yeah.
And
Gurren Lagann we should watch, because it's actually... I've gotten to the first, like, four episodes, and it's... in the last recording, I was talking about who's the sad robot boy.
Yeah.
Real quick, before this one wraps up, the typical mecha pilot in anime was, like, the hot-blooded sort. It's like, yeah, let's go do this! And then Evangelion was made as a direct counterpoint to that, to where it's supposed to be like, you know, this is a child being thrown into life-or-death situations, and so they want to show that...
The fuckless fuck.
Yeah, they want to show the fuckless fuck and the, you know, scared reality of being a child in this situation. And so that's fine. But then everything after that was aping that, where suddenly it's the cold-blooded, hesitant, slightly cowardly pilot who gets forced into the situation. And so Gurren Lagann is a counterpoint to that, to bring it back to the original.
Brilliant.
Yeah, because the main character starts off as that, but his best friend is the hot-blooded sword.
Yeah.
And then the main character very quickly has to become the hot-blooded sword.
I think I watched the first episode so of that, because I remember they lived underground and
they came
out from... Yeah, I want to watch that.
In terms of scale, it's not a spoiler to say where it goes. It goes to space.
Yeah,
it goes
like
to
space whales or space birds or something. Or
they always show birds around stuff to show, you know, just how big something is.
Yeah.
And so it goes from the smallest situation where it's Simon with his little drill underground to breaking through the dome to get on Earth and then going into space and higher until, you know, he goes from the smallest possible thing to literally half the size of the visible universe.
How long is that series?
I think the series is only... It's one season.
That's
it's like
good.
20 episodes. Same thing with Kill la Kill.
Sometimes
that's... Which we should also watch.
Yeah.
So it's that, and then I think there are a couple of movies which wrap everything up.
I feel like sometimes I can only do those single season animes.
That's all I want out of an anime. Maybe three if it's really good, like Fullmetal Alchemist.
But yeah.
You know, if they sat down and they scoped out the story and it's like, it's going to be three seasons.
Yeah.
Instead of like, let's just see how long we can drag this out.